and welcome to Boss Raid, the show where we take an in-depth look at the bosses in a video game. In the anticipation of the recently announced remake of the 1993 Link's Awakening for the Game Boy, the game we're covering, of course, is just that. Specifically, we'll be covering Link's Awakening DX, which was a Game Boy Color re-release that had a few new features, such as more bosses. The game opens with our protagonist, the same hero from A Link to the Past, according to the official player's guide, battling a storm at sea. His ship is struck by lightning and eventually he washes up on the beach of the island Koholint, where he's found by Marin. Shortly thereafter, our hero reacquires his sword and is nudged in the general direction of adventure by a mysterious owl. There are 8 instruments of the Sirens to collect, each hidden away in a dungeon, and each dungeon inhabited by not only a boss, but a mini-boss, and sometimes more than one. After a bit of story questing, we find ourselves at our first destination, Tail Cave. We pick up Rock's Feather here, which is needed not only to get to the first mini-boss, but to also jump over the rolling spike log that it throws at us. Once that obstacle has been avoided, it's simply a matter of sword slashing until Rolling Bones is defeated. If you're fast enough, you can kill off Bones before it has a chance to roll the spike log a second time. Winning this fight leads almost immediately to the next. In this game, the bosses are referred to as nightmares, and here we face our first nightmare, Moldorm. Moldorm will do typical Moldorm stuff, moving around the room in a random pattern, and can knock Link off the edge and down into the dungeon below. If knocked down, you have to climb back up and start the fight all over again. If it wasn't obvious enough, Moldorm's weak point is its tail, which needs to be hit 3 times to fell the nightmare. We collect our first instrument, which the owl tells us we need to wake some giant wind fish. Better make our way to the next instrument quickly. Equipped with Rock's Feather, the world opens up a little bit, but we still can't quite get to the next dungeon. Incidentally, Bow Wow, the friendly chain chomp from the starting village, has been kidnapped. To get him back, we must infiltrate the Moblin's base and defeat the King Moblin. This is a pretty easy fight. He'll throw a few spears out which can be dodged or simply deflected with a shield. After a while, the king will charge, simply sidestep, and the king will run into the wall, stunning himself for a few seconds. This is the only time he can be attacked. Once defeated, Bow Wow joins the party, and Bow Wow can eat enemies, but more importantly, he can eat these flower things that are blocking the way to Bottle Grotto, the second dungeon. The mini-boss is Hinox, and it's another laughably easy fight. It can throw bombs and charge at Link, but thankfully the charge can be broken by attacking. If the charge is successful, Hinox will grab Link and throw him, dealing a full heart of damage. There are also some hazards along the wall that are easily avoidable. I was able to take down Hinox with 4 quick spin attacks. Unlike Tail Cave, we still have a bit to do after the mini-boss before taking on the next nightmare. We find another important item, the Power Bracelet, which helps us navigate to Bottle Grotto's guardian, Genie. At the start of the encounter, he'll announce that he's the bad guy this time, and also offer helpful hints on how to defeat him throughout. Genie has a few stages. At first, there only seems to be a bottle that you can't do any damage to. Eventually, Genie pops out and will throw flaming balls at Link. They're pretty easy to avoid, and after he's thrown all of his balls, Genie will retreat into the bottle, which will now chase Link and damage him upon contact. The trick here is to stab the bottle with a sword, then pick it up using the recently acquired power bracelet, then simply toss the bottle anywhere and it'll take damage. This is the only way to damage the boss. Genie will once again pop out and start throwing fireballs again. Repeat the process of dodging them, hitting, and then throwing the bottle 2 more times and Genie will be no more. Out of the dungeon and into the overworld, a little bit of questing, a little bit of trading, and eventually we can enter Key Cavern. About halfway to the nightmare of Key Cavern, we meet the mini-boss, a pair of Dodongo snakes. Once again, it's time to bomb some Dodongos. Thankfully, there is a floating bomb pickup in a nearby room that gives us 10 bombs when collected. The idea here is to feed each Dodongo 3 bombs. This can be a little tricky as they move randomly. You can place a bomb, then pick it up and try to throw it into their mouths, or simply leave it in a Dodongo's path and hope that it doesn't decide to change directions. The easiest strategy that I found was to simply walk up to the snake's mouth and drop a bomb right on its face. It's a little dangerous, but the most reliable method in my experience. There's an exit from this fight if you happen to run out of bombs, but with a bit of luck, it shouldn't take more than 10 bombs to finish the fight. In the very next room, we find the Pegasus Boots, which allows us the useful ability to dash. After that, we find and use a few keys until we find the boss room, the Lair of Slime Eye. At first, it would seem that the boss is nowhere to be found. Slime Eye even taunts us to further the frustration of finding it. Green Zoles will drop infinitely from the ceiling at a max of 2 per screen. As usual, the trick involves the new toy that we acquired within the current dungeon. Dash into a wall and Slime Eye will drop from the ceiling. At this point, no more Zoles will appear. Next, we need to slice its slime eye to make it split into two, and once it's almost completely separated from itself, we dash through the middle to make two separate slime eyes. If the dash isn't fast enough, Slime Eye will slowly reform itself. Anyway, once Slime Eye is now slime eyes, we have to land 3 hits on each one. Each time a hit is landed on one of the slime eyes, it will jump up and then fall back to the ground, trying to land on Link and shaking the ground when it lands. If Link is standing on the ground when this happens, he'll be knocked down and left vulnerable for a few seconds. Rock's Feather is the way to avoid this. Time it right and jump into the air just as an eye lands on the ground. It's best to focus on one eye at a time. Things can get crazy with both eyes jumping around. Poke the eyes until they die, and that's it for Dungeon 3. As usual, there's a bunch of stuff to do in the overworld before we can get to the next dungeon. We acquire Marin to help us wake the sleeping walrus who's blocking our path to the Yarna Desert, and once in the desert, we find Landmola, a mini-boss so easy that it's barely worth mentioning. Landmola will randomly jump out, fly over the sand for a short distance, then dig back into the sand, and stay there for a few seconds before popping out and doing it all over again. It causes contact damage but can easily be dispatched with just a few spin slashes. Once it's defeated, Landmola drops the key to our next proper dungeon, Angler's Tunnel. The theme of Angler's Tunnel is water, and lots of it. Our mini-boss Q-Ball is a dweller of shallow waters. Q-Ball can only be damaged by attacking its big back head spot thingy. It's easiest to hit when Q-Ball is turning a corner, and when you do land a hit, Q-Ball turns around and starts heading in the opposite direction. In fact, this fight can be ended quickly by waiting around a corner, timing your attack just right, then running over to the other corner to repeat. Two rooms later, we get another useful progression item, the flippers. Sadly, the nightmare of this tunnel is extremely disappointing. The angler will just swim up and down and occasionally make a charge attack that will cause bricks to fall from the ceiling. The angler will also call in some helpers occasionally, but there's nothing too difficult to handle here. I had also just so happened to have picked up a piece of power right before this fight, which is a power-up that doubles sword damage for a short time, and with it I was able to take down the angler in about 4 hits. We now have 4 of the 8 instruments, but there is a lot we can do before getting the 5th. The world has opened up even more now thanks to the flippers, and even though we have a few warp points, overworld traversal is a bit tedious. Anyway, the first thing on our list is an optional sword upgrade. If you collect 20 of the 26 seashells hidden throughout the island, which becomes possible at around this time, you can upgrade Link's sword to level 2. This sword does more damage, and of course shoots laser beams when Link is at full health. Nice. I also decide to acquire the bow at this point, no need to ever go back into that shop again. And now is also a great time to complete Color Dungeon, a dungeon only accessible on the DX version and only when played on a Game Boy Color. This dungeon is shorter than the others and has color-based puzzles that I guess wouldn't make much sense with the original Game Boy's limited palette. This dungeon is also filled with mini-bosses. The first is a stone Hinox, though I think I prefer its Japanese name, Dekudon. Only slightly more difficult of a fight than its non-stone counterpart, Dekudon will move around slowly and occasionally jump up and slam into the ground. As usual, if Link's on the ground when this happens, he'll fall down and be stunned for a few seconds. This ground pound also causes large rocks to fall from the ceiling, not to mention the spikes sticking out of the ground, and the fact that landing a hit on Dekudon comes with some knockback to Link, which can send him flying into one of the many on-screen hazards. It could be that I'm just bad at video games, but I couldn't seem to time my jumps right to avoid being knocked down. The screen seemed to shake forever, but overall this is still a very easy fight. Bombs are super effective here, but I decided to just use my shiny new level 2 sword. The next mini-boss is called Giant Buzz Blob, because that's what it is. If you try to attack with a sword, it will straight up tell you that that won't work and suggest trying something else. How nice of it. At first I tried bombs, but the secret is magic powder. One sprinkle and it'll turn into a ball form. This only took one hit, though I did have a piece of power upgrade active. Easiest fight so far? Maybe. And that's saying something. Finally, we get to the Nightmare of Color dungeon, Evil Orb. It will say something about blue being good, yellow being caution, and red being danger, but at this point, it doesn't really matter. I still had my piece of power upgrade active, so all I had to do was slash a few times, and the orb dropped easily. After defeating Evil Orb, we're met by the Great Fairy, who gives us a choice between a blue tunic that cuts all damage received in half, or a red tunic which doubles sword damage and sends enemies flying when hit. Kind of like a permanent piece of power without the move speed bonus that it gives Link. The blue tunic is a good choice for balance, seeing as how the sword is already at level 2, but in my opinion the best defense is a good offense, so it's the red tunic for me. Also, once we get the boomerang, health will be even less of an issue, and the best part is that the tunic also stacks with power pieces, so if I collect one, it will be 4 times stronger than the base level 2 sword. Awesome. And as a quick side note, you can always come back and go through Color Dungeon again to swap tunics if you so desire. But for us, it's time to move on. After a bit more trade questing in the overworld, we can finally enter Catfish's Maw. Shortly after entering, we encounter Master Stalfos. Master Stalfos will jump around and swing with a sword. He can only be attacked around his head from the side that's not protected by a giant shield. Once you tap him with your sword, he will crumble, only to reanimate after a few seconds. Having had some experiences with his kind in the past, I knew to drop a bomb while he was down to damage him. In fact, you can kind of stunlock him by readying your sword just as he's about to reanimate. After 3 dropping bombs, Master Stalfos will concede and run away. Now, usually after defeating a mid-boss, we receive an important progression item. However, it would seem that Master Stalfos, out of shame, jealousy, or just embarrassment of his defeat, has taken the item for himself, challenging us to take it back from him. Maybe not the best of plans, considering he just got his tailbone handed to him. We see him 2 more times in 2 separate rooms. Each time it's the same fight, except this time it only takes 2 bombs to make him flee. We encounter him for a 4th and final time in the last room, and again, it takes 3 bombs just like the first fight, but this time he's been murdered thoroughly and drops the all-important hookshot. Now we can go through these rooms that were teasing us earlier and make our way towards the nightmare. However, we have the option to make a quick stop and fight an optional boss on the way. And of course, we're not going to skip any optional boss on boss raid. This is Goma, and we fight not one, but 2 here in the middle of the dungeon. Each Goma will move back and forth in a line, but will occasionally start to shake, and when this happens, it's about to lunge at Link, so be ready to dodge. The only other thing that Goma will do is stop completely for a few seconds. When this happens, it will open its eye and spit out a fireball shortly after. This is when you need to attack. You can attack the eye with either the bow or the hookshot, which takes a total of 3 and 6 hits respectively. If you're fast enough, you can get off all 3 bow shots at once for a quick kill. It's also possible to get 3 hookshots in, making a 2 cycle possible. It's a little harder to dodge the bottom Goma's attacks as you have less room, but once it's gone you have pretty much the entire room to use to your advantage for the second Goma. You can also stand in between the 2 Gomas and they'll attack you at the same time, but that's a terrible strategy and I don't recommend it at all. Anyway, with the optional boss optionally defeated, it's time to go to the non-optional boss, Slime Eel. Slime Eel is kind of a weird boss. It has a giant spiky tail spinning around the room constantly that can't be damaged, but can damage the heck out of Link. Eel will randomly poke its head out of one of the 4 holes in the wall. You need to hookshot the head just as the mouth opens and try to be a good distance away. That way you'll have enough time to run up and slash its exposed heart as many times as you can. Once you get some attacks in, the tail will start spinning in the other direction. Sometimes instead of exposing its heart, it will just jump out and explode. This boss can be a bit annoying, as it can get tricky dodging everything and trying to time your hookshots and attacks just right. It took me 3 tries, but on the 3rd I got a perfect fight, no explodey eels and no damage taken. Easily the hardest boss so far, yet still quite easy once you learn the patterns. Upon its death, it gives us a cryptic message. It's probably nothing, so let's just continue. We pick up the boomerang, which pretty much one-shots everything. There is a kind of pseudo-mini-boss on the way, an Armos Knight that can try to jump on Link, again a floor shaker, 3 hits from the sword, and I am glad I picked up the red tunic. The plot thickens a bit as we find out the island we're on, Koholint, is some kind of Schrodinger's Xanarkand. Without putting too much thought into it, we head to Face Shrine. For the first time, we get a progression item before even seeing a boss. This time it's an upgrade to our power bracelet. We find our way to Smasher, a cute little guy who just wants to play ball with Link. Smasher will pick up and throw its ball, but if Link can pick it up before Smasher gets to it, he can throw it at Smasher to cause damage. Four tosses to Smasher's face is enough to defeat it. It's probably possible to pick up the ball before Smasher even gets another chance at it, but I'm not that good. Earlier, I made a comment that the boomerang would alleviate some of our health problems, and here's why. It one-shots enemies such as these sparks, which these dungeons are littered with, and they almost always drop a fairy, in fact I think they always do, which of course restores many of our precious hearts. We continue through the cave encountering our old friends, the Dodongo Snakes. They're just as easy to kill as ever. The nightmare of this cave is Facade. Facade is a face on the ground. The fight is similar to the one in Oracle of Seasons, though here Facade is a boss proper instead of just a mini-boss. You just need to keep dropping bombs on Facade's face as often as possible. Tiles will rise from the floor as well as pots, all in an attempt to hit Link. Once there's nothing left to throw, Facade will start opening small holes in the ground. Again, just keep bombing Facade's face, which I assume is also his body, and once defeated, Facade reveals a bit more information about this island mystery, and maybe we should be concerned at this point. We continue on, and a rooster joins in on our adventure for a while, because that's just how Link rolls. He helps us make it to the next dungeon, Eagle's Tower. Again, we find our important item before even a mini-boss, and again, it's an upgrade. The Mirror Shield. Yay. We find another Hinox, but at this point, it's more of a glorified enemy than a mini-boss. Four hits with either the sword or the boomerang, and it's over. The true mini-boss here is the Grim Creeper. The Creeper doesn't fight us directly. Instead, he summons bats to fight for him. He'll spawn in six bats that will fly towards Link before flying away off-screen. After the first assault, the Creeper taunts Link and summons more bats. He will continuously summon waves of bats until you can defeat all six before they fly off the screen. Actually, if you can defeat the entire first wave of bats, the Creeper will still taunt you but immediately go to his defeated speech. It kind of looks like the game didn't expect you to actually do that. Before escaping himself, the Creeper swears his revenge upon Link. Now all we have to do is navigate
the most dungeon ever created,
and we can reach the Nightmare of Eagle's Tower, Evil Eagle, who seems to be under the command of the Grim Creeper. I was able to defeat the eagle with a poke and two spin attacks to the beak. I think it was supposed to have some more attacks, but it fell too quickly for me to see them. Honestly, it was an anticlimactic fight for such an arduous dungeon, but we still have one more to go. For the first time in the game, there's very little to do between dungeons. We play the frog's Song of Soul at the entrance to Turtle Rock Dungeon, and when we do, the stone statue comes to life and attacks. This pseudo mini-boss is named Turtle Rock, just like the dungeon he's guarding. Turtle Rock moves around slowly and is extremely weak, dying after four hits from the sword. Once Turtle Rock is defeated, we can enter Turtle Rock. Though it shares a namesake with the dungeon in A Link to the Past, the similarities pretty much end there. As we work our way through, we run into some old friends. Hinox is here, this time in blue, and gone in four boomerang hits. Rolling Bones is here, and gone in three sword hits. Smasher is here, and it's the same fight as last time, throw the ball at it four times. We also see the Dodongo Snakes again. This time they present a bit of a puzzle. When we first encounter them, we're in the same room with them. If we defeat them here, we won't be able to open the chest that spawns, as it's out of reach, and by the time we get there, they will have respawned and the chest will have disappeared. Instead, we have to clear out a bit more of the dungeon until we can stand on the ledge and defeat the snakes by throwing bombs at them. I thought this was a pretty neat way of recycling this fight without making it trivial like the other reused bosses, though Link's never in any real danger unless you hold a bomb too long. Eventually, we find our way to a boss we haven't seen before, at least not in this game, Blano, the mini-boss of Turtle Rock. He tries to hit Link with his giant boxing gloves. Blano has a few different attacks. He can unleash a flurry of punches or go into a wind-up attack. He also has a huge wind-up attack that will send Link flying back to the start of the dungeon. Of course, this attack has a very long wind-up animation, and you should see it coming from a mile away. It can be hard to hit Blano directly. He doesn't take damage from the front, so the key is to try to catch him when he overextends a punch and misses, or while he's recovering from a wind-up attack. Blano doesn't do much damage at this point, and he's no match for Link, falling in just a few sword slashes. Blano runs off to presumably start his own gem someday, and allows us to collect the magic rod. We're not quite done with past mini-bosses. We find Q-Ball guarding the room with the boss key. This fight is essentially the same as before, except now there's lava on the ground. At first I tried using the boomerang, but that had no effect, so two slashes with the sword did the trick. Not too long after that, we finally get to the boss of Turtle Rock, Hothead. Hothead is a relatively simple fight. It'll jump out of the lava, splashing it out in four directions when it does. If these splashes hit Link, they can do some serious damage. Thankfully, they're not too hard to avoid, even though Link's movement is limited here. To hurt Hothead, we need to fight fire with fire, meaning use the magic rod. Once hit with the magic rod, Hothead's head flames will recede, and it will start to maneuver in a way that can only be described as DVD screensavering. The strategy remains the same, keep hitting it with the fire rod. You can actually sort of stunlock Hothead if you're fast enough. I tried a few times to lock it in place with the first hit and kill it without letting it get away again. It might be possible to do this, but I wasn't able to. After doing a bunch of damage, Hothead's outer shell will break, revealing some kind of weird creature within. It will go back to jumping in and out of the lava. Just keep blasting it with the fire rod, and this nightmare should be quick work. We now have all eight instruments, and our journey draws close to its end. With everything more or less wrapped up in the overworld, we can head now to our final dungeon, the Windfish Egg. The dungeon itself is extremely simple, just navigating a bunch of empty rooms in just the right order, similarly to the Lost Woods from other games. The correct order can be found by reading a book in the library, and by correctly navigating the rooms, we end up in the last room of the game where our final battle takes place. Here we face off against the final nightmare, which takes multiple shadow forms. The first form is that of a giant shadow Zol. It simply blobs around and occasionally disappears, only to reappear in another location. When attacked with the sword, it disperses and reappears a short time later. The secret is the magic powder. Sprinkle magic powder on it three times and it transforms into Aghanim's shadow. Its movement and attacks are similar to Aghanim's in A Link to the Past. It moves around from spot to spot, charging, and then firing magic projectiles at Link, who must deflect them back using the sword. After doing this four times, the nightmare transforms again, this time into Shadow Moldorm. Although it moves faster here, one could argue that this fight is easier, as there's no risk of falling through the floor. Three pokes and a spin slash to the tail was enough to coax it into its next form, Shadow Ganon. This is a simplified version of the Ganon fight from A Link to the Past. Ganon will summon fire bats that fly towards Link. He will also move around the room and throw out his trident. Six spin slashes takes us to our next form, Shadow Lanmola, though it doesn't behave like a typical Lanmola. It will simply try to run itself into Link indefinitely. It can be blocked by the shield, but a regular sword slash doesn't do anything. One quick shot from the magic rod will do the trick, and the shadow will go through one final transformation. This is Deatheye, the game's final boss. A large black blob with two blobby arms swinging around it. Deatheye doesn't actually do much besides float back and forth around the room, roughly in Link's general direction. Touching any part of Deatheye causes contact damage to Link. The body does half a heart while the arms deal two hearts of damage. There are two ways to go about this fight. The first is to use arrows. As it's moving back and forth, occasionally Deatheye will open its eye and can be shot with an arrow. There are a few things making this difficult. First, the eye must be fully open for the shot to cause damage, which is maybe about a 1 second window. On top of this, oftentimes when the eye is open, the arms will be out in front of Deatheye, making it impossible to take a shot without taking damage. Deatheye can also take a long time before it decides to open its eye again, making you wait not only for the eye to open, but also for the right time to strike. Rock's Feather is essential for jumping over the arms and avoiding taking damage. While it's not too hard to get the timing down, the arms will start moving faster the more damage that Deatheye takes. Though this makes dodging a little harder, it also has a chance to create more openings as the arms will move away from bad positions faster. This is easily the hardest fight in the game, not because of anything particularly difficult, but just because of how prolonged this fight can be. If you really want to be safe here and you took the red mail like I did earlier, you can always go back to Color Dungeon before coming here and swap out your red tunic for the blue one, which once again cuts all damage received in half, and there's no need for the sword here. Thankfully, I had a red potion on me which fully restores your health if it reaches zero, but if you're not terrible at video games like I am, you probably won't even need that. This is more a test of endurance than anything. Take your time, avoid taking damage, time your attacks just right, and after 16 well-placed shots, Deatheye will fall, and the nightmare is over. But wait, there's another way to defeat Deatheye. Instead of doing all that nonsense with the bow, pull out the boomerang, wait for the eye to open, and hit it once. And that's it, game over. Thanks to the single most OP weapon in the game. So I take back what I just said about Deatheye. This is probably the easiest boss in the game. What a ride. So with Death Eye defeated, we experience the Windfish's awakening. It turns out that the island of Koholint and all of our experiences there were just a dream of the Windfish, and nothing we did really mattered. Such is life. So that's Link's awakening. Overall, I'd say the bosses were underwhelming, but they served their purpose, and they fit the game well. The real challenge of Link's Awakening are the dungeons themselves, especially some of the later ones. I'd never played this game before, but I ended up really liking it. I figured I would, seeing as how I've previously said that Oracle of Seasons is my favorite game in the series. But anyway, I had a lot of fun playing it, and I really enjoyed making this video, and I hope you enjoyed watching it. As always, thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time on Boss Raid.